The movie opens in England on a peaceful afternoon, which is suddenly interrupted by the ringing alarms of the Bank of London, mobilizing cops all over the city. Thief Lao Xing manages to escape the building through a window and hides inside a tailor's cart, which provides him with a new suit that will help him go unnoticed. New clothes aren't enough though, and since the cops are still around, Lao climbs a tree to avoid them. That's when he notices that the garden he's hidden in belongs to eccentric scientist Valet, who is having an argument with his valet over his dangerous experiments. The valet is tired of putting his life at risk because of his boss' crazy ideas, and right after he quits, Lao falls off the tree into the garden. Seeing as he still needs a place to hide, he pretends to be Valet's new valet, claiming to be half French to be hired. Not interested in looking a gift horse in the mouth, Valet immediately puts Lao on his latest machine, which finally manages to break the 50-mile-per-hour speed barrier but also sends Lao flying through the city, causing chaos everywhere he bumps against. Excited about this development, Valet goes to rescue him, but Lao can start seeing why the last valet quit now. Unfortunately, since the police haven't given up on finding him yet, Lao has no choice but to accept the job. Meanwhile at the Royal Academy of Science, the officers of Scotland Yard announce that the Jade Buddha has been stolen. Baron Kelvin, the Minister of Science, is furious and begins throwing things at the cops until he's interrupted by Fawn, the General of the Black Scorpions. She was the first person to steal the Buddha from its original owners, planning to use it to buy assistance from the British Army. However, Kelvin refuses to respect the deal if he doesn't have the Buddha, so Fawn will have to send her men to recover it. Back in Valet's house, the scientist is teaching Lao all about the various machines that provide the house with this thing called electricity. He also shows him the invention he sadly hasn't been to finish yet, a flying machine. Sometime later, Lao sneaks into the office to write a letter to his father back in China, promising to bring back the village's protector soon. Afterward, Lao's next chore is helping Valet get into the Royal Academy while he wears his wheelie shoes. Valet wants to present his machine that can break the speed barrier, but he's never taken seriously as a scientist, and Kelvin reminds him that everything worth knowing has already been discovered. Their argument is suddenly interrupted when a man requests to speak about the madhouse the bank has become, and when everyone begins mentioning rumors about a Chinese thief acting alone, Lao begins inserting some rumors of his own to change the story into a gang of elderly Norwegians. Valet finds all this talk of catching the thief ridiculous since if the man wanted to, by taking the correct means of transport at an exact time, he could be back in China in exactly 80 days. As soon as he hears this, Lao knows it's what he needs, so he spreads another rumor that prompts Kelvin into daring Valet to go around the world and return to England in 80 days. Valet will take the bet only if he can ask for Kelvin's place as Minister of Science as a reward, and to everyone's surprise, Kelvin accepts. But if Valet loses, he'll have to abandon his career as a scientist and never invent again. Soon, a crowd forms around Valet's house, ready to send him off, but Valet is afraid he'll lose everything and doesn't want to go. Lao reminds him to defend his beliefs and that he has his valet's help, inspiring Valet to finally leave the house in order to start their adventure. On their way out in Valet's weird car invention, they're stopped by corrupt Inspector Fix, who has been paid by Kelvin to arrest them with the excuse that their contraption violates the city's vehicle code. Valet and Lao jump off the car, expecting to make Fix see reason, but the problem gets solved on its own when Fix grabs the car with too much force and makes it malfunction. The car drags Fix with it until it crashes, and Valet and Lao take the chance to borrow the officer's own vehicle so they can catch their ship in time. All this is seen by Kelvin and Fong, who immediately make plans to send their people overseas. 2 days later, Lao and Valet make it to Paris. Suddenly, Lao notices there are many black scorpions hiding among the people in the street, so he drags Valet into an art fair by pretending is Edison's latest science demonstration. Valet absolutely hates it as soon as they enter, but artist Monique manages to teach him the wonders of Impressionism by showing him a painting of a flying man. While Valet and Monique bond over their analysis of Monique's sketches, the black scorpions find Lao and chase him into the floor above the fair, where Lao shows his amazing martial art skills by fighting them all at the same time, using any object found in the room for help. Even if Lao manages to win though, the danger is real, so he wastes no time going downstairs to warn Valet. Seeing her new friend is in danger, Monique grabs her painting and guides the men through a secret passage, allowing them to escape safely. A moment later, they come out from a manhole in the middle of the street, where Monique asks Valet to take her with them when he mentions compensation for her help. Before Valet can consider the offer, Lao notices the black scorpions are still coming after them and proposes they make up for the lost time by taking an air balloon. The idea is well received and the group cuts in line to take over the balloon, which requires less weight aboard to fly properly. When Valet throws out some of their extra bags, Lao panics because one of those has all their money and, most importantly, the Buddha, and it is now being taken by an old lady. Lao jumps off the balloon and takes the bag from the woman, which gets him bitten by the lady and seen by the black scorpions. After tossing the bag up to Phileas, Lao holds onto the balloon's rope while trying to fight off the black scorpions at the same time. This ends up with Lao being dragged through Paris and bumping in all kinds of buildings and objects until he gets stuck on a statue, only managing to escape by leaving his pants behind. Once Lao gets back in the balloon, Phileas informs Monique that she can't come with them. However, Monique doesn't give up and keeps on following them later when the men take the Orient Express train. After an argument over her refusal to leave them alone, Phileas leaves for another train car, and Monique takes the chance to tell Lao that she noticed those strange warriors are after him, which means he's lying. Finding himself cornered, Lao has no choice but to explain that the sacred Buddha had been stolen from his village, so now he's on a mission to take it back before Warlord Fong can take over his home. Monique accepts to keep his secret, but under one condition: Lao must help her convince Phileas that she should come along. When Phileas is brought back by the angry conductors that didn't want to hear scientific advice on how to improve the train, Lao lies again and tells him he's found out Monique is his cousin through the French side of his family. Phileas is still unsure though, thus Monique goes to see the conductors, and using her charms, she convinces them to follow Phileas' advice to make the train go faster. This grants them access to the first-class car as a reward, and Phileas finally accepts to keep her around. When Lao enters the kitchen to get some tea, he bumps into Fix, who immediately recognizes him. To protect the mission, Lao hits him a couple of times before tossing him off the train through the window. By day 10, the group makes it to Turkey. It's not their intention to stop in Istanbul, but Prince Happy sends his warriors to force them to come to his palace for dinner. Monique is very impressed by Happy's musical skills and marvelous art collection, which includes a statue of himself that Happy is very protective of. Getting irrationally jealous, Phileas accepts to stay to just keep an eye on them. While they have dinner in a huge tub, Happy confesses he wants to make Monique his seventh wife and won't take a no for an answer. With a plan in mind, Phileas and Lao pretend to leave the palace to give the lovebirds some time alone, only to stop by Happy's favorite statue and threaten to break it if he doesn't release Monique. Desperate, Happy keeps his guards back and allows Monique to go, but in his excitement, Phileas ends up breaking the statue anyway. This causes Happy to send his men after them, but on their way out, the trio uses part of the statue to lock the door and escape safely. In London, Kelvin receives a telegram from Fix, informing him that the thief and Phileas' valet are the same person. Now they think the bet was a ruse to escape with the Buddha, so Kelvin sends orders to the British soldiers in India to capture Phileas and Lao for robbery. By day 24, the trio is on a train to India. Lao keeps the kids aboard entertained with stories about a legendary group of Chinese warriors called the Ten Tigers, but Phileas disapproves of stories that aren't based on facts. Their conversation is suddenly interrupted when the train is forced to stop at Agra in order for British soldiers to search the cars for the wanted men. Fortunately, the trio hears about this through the windows and leaves the train to mingle in the city while dressed up as locals. The heat isn't well received by Phileas though, and when he begins to feel unwell, he runs to the nearest privy only to bump into Fix. Recognition is inevitable, so Phileas hits him with the door before passing out. Lao and Monique come to his rescue, dragging his body into a merchant's cart that is soon stopped by the black scorpions. Monique is tied to the cart while Lao tries to escape, but he only ends up bumping into Fix too, who handcuffs their hands together. Now Lao has to fight a scorpion while handling Fix's presence by his side. Meanwhile, Monique manages to free herself, only to be found by a female scorpion that wastes no time coming after her. Luckily, Phileas wakes up then and comes to her rescue using the special contraption he's hidden inside his cane. This contraption hits a nearby shop and the falling objects fall on top of the warrior, knocking her out and allowing the duo to escape. Back to Lao, he's running through the city while using Fix as his shield, which eventually makes him pass out. After pulling a few tricks, Lao knocks out the scorpion too and returns to his friend's side, who help him find the cuff's key and dress Fix in Phileas' clothes to then put him in a cart. As they push the cart away, they yell that's the wanted criminal, and the soldiers go after it. Now the trio needs to go to a place with no British colonies in it, so Lao offers China as an option. They make it to Lao's village by day 41, and to keep his lie up, Lao asks the locals to receive Phileas and Monique with as much enthusiasm as they receive him. While Lao returns the Buddha to its rightful owner, Phileas and Monique mingle with the townspeople, getting to learn their culture. After an evening spent drinking, Phileas looks for a room to sleep his hangover off and ends up finding Lao's pictures with his family plus the letter he had sent his dad. By confronting Lao, Phileas learns the truth, and his mood gets worse when he hears Monique come to Lao's defense. Heartbroken, Phileas accuses them of having used him and put him through great danger for nothing before he leaves. Lao goes after him, intending to make things better, only to discover the black scorpions have captured Phileas. While the black scorpions search the village for the Buddha, Lao, Monique, and Phileas are left in wood cages outside. When the scorpions can't find the figurine, the leader threatens the trio, trying to make them confess the Buddha's location. Staying brave, Lao appeals to the warrior's ego and challenges him to a duel. The fight is fierce and Lao should easily win it, but the scorpion leader cheats and gets the help of his warriors to achieve victory. The trio is about to lose hope when suddenly, a new group of warriors arrive. It's the 10 Tigers, confirming the legend is true and Lao is actually part of the team. By working together, the 10 Tigers defeat the Black Scorpions with ease, and Lao makes the leader swear on his honor that they won't return to the village. Once the battle is done, the Buddha is finally returned to its temple, but Phileas refuses to stay and hear what Monique and Lao have to say, instead opting to travel alone. By day 61, Phileas makes it to San Francisco, where he bumps into a woman that pretends to be hurt, but this is only a trick to distract him and steal all his bags. 3 days later, Phileas is nothing but a hobo on the streets, and not even following another tramp's advice can help him get any change from the locals. The only thing he has left is a notebook in the pockets of his jackets, where he keeps Monique's flying man painting. Phileas likes staring at the painting to remember his lost dreams, and that's how he notices a message on the back that he didn't see before. It's a note from Monique saying that she traveled the world looking for inspiration and found it in him. He begins to wonder if he had been wrong about his traveling companions when suddenly, Lao and Monique appear before him, having traveled all the way to the USA to help him win his bet. Touched by their concern and finally accepting them as true friends, Phileas takes them back and accepts to travel together again. Meanwhile in London, Fawn tries to convince Kelvin to lend her some British soldiers again, this time promising to share the jade reserves from Lao's village. Kelvin accepts this new deal, but also reminds her that he won't have power over the army if he loses the bet, so Fawn promises to cut Phileas' journey short. By day 66, the trio is stuck in the American desert. The wheel of their car has broken and Lao has left to ask for help, but he passes out in the middle of the road because of dehydration. While Phileas and Monique discuss their options, they're found by the Wright brothers, who are big fans of Phileas and have Lao in the back of their cart. They help the group fix their vehicle, and before they leave, Phileas gives them a few tips for their flying machine as a gesture of gratitude. On day 72, the trio makes it to New York, where a huge crowd is waiting for them. The news of Phileas' bet has spread and now the entire country is cheering for him. Unfortunately, this crowd also makes it hard for them to reach their ship, at least until they're found by an Irish cop that is a fan of any person that steals from the British. This cop promises to show them a shortcut, but once the trio is dragged away, they discover it's all a trap and now they're stuck in an old workshop with Fong and her men. Lao tells Phileas and Monique to run away as he starts yet another fight by himself. Defeating the men isn't hard if he uses the props in the room as a weapon, but Fong is a tough cookie. A horn can be heard in the distance, announcing the ship to London is about to leave, but Phileas considers his friend's life more important and comes back to help Lao win the fight by dropping a giant prop on top of Fong, who is then knocked out by Monique when she surprises her from behind. There should be another ship leaving for London soon, but Phileas doesn't think they'll make it in time. Lao refuses to let him embrace hopelessness, reminding him they've survived too many dangers to give up now, and the trio rushes to the port to catch the next ship. The next day, they're already sailing through the Atlantic Ocean. The captain is a big fan too and accepts to burn all the coal they have to go faster, but this only allows them to gain 6 hours, and their delays a whole day. Phileas is about to give up but inspiration suddenly strikes when he looks up and notices a bunch of birds flying. If he combines the physics of a bird's flight and the Wright brothers' steering system, he can finally make the flying machine he's always dreamed of. To achieve this, they'll have to break down the ship, and the captain accepts after Phileas promises to pay him enough to get an even better vessel later. Thanks to everyone's hard work, the machine is ready to go on day 80 with only 5 hours left to reach London. After Phileas and Monique celebrate with a kiss, the trio takes off, successfully flying all the way back to England only for the machine to start coming apart when they're about to reach London. Fortunately, Lao's and Phileas' combined efforts allow them to land right in front of the Royal Academy without anyone getting hurt. It's too soon to celebrate though. Kelvin is there as well, sending Scotland Yard to arrest the trio right as the Big Ben announces their time has run out. Since a crowd is forming around them, Monique tells everyone about the crimes Kelvin committed, and the other Academy lords plus Fix back her up because they're tired of Kelvin's bullying. However, Kelvin laughs at their faces, reminding them he still holds power and they can do nothing to make him pay. His gloating speech is suddenly interrupted by Queen Victoria, who immediately orders Scotland Yard to arrest Kelvin and confesses she had bet on Phileas' side. To help him, Victoria makes a very simple yet accurate observation. Phileas has been calculating his time according to other time zones, but here in England, he still has 24 hours left before the challenge is over. Bubbling with excitement, the trio runs up the stairs of the Royal Academy, where Phileas finally officially becomes the Minister of Science.